Yeah. So how often do you have to feed this guy?
Never. Although people voluntarily try to stick their head in his mouth all the time.
Can you see Seattle from here?
On a really clear day.
So these are all fawns.
So you're showing here in Santa Ana.
Yeah.
What's up with this piece right here?
It's about, it's got an image, a Rococo image of these little like water babies in it. There's like a humanoid baby figure that has a sea serpent tail and...
It reminds me of if art dealers had kids, it would look like this.
They could. They could. It's, they're artistic children.
Artistic children?
Yeah, artistic children. And there's this big, like, bug, sort of like, almost like a scarab beetle type of shape floating around. You know, almost like a guardian angel in a way. But it could be menacing, too.
And since when do they start having galleries in Santa Ana? Is that part of the new gentrification project?
Some people might describe it like that.
Years?
35 years.
Wow, okay.
That's a long time.
Yeah, so do you collect all this stuff, or how do you acquire, like, these old Playboy magazines and...
I buy out whole companies.
Oh, okay.
I don't buy individual items.
I could tell. Yeah,
I've got five warehouses jammed full. All this stuff, all in banana boxes.
Oh my gosh.
It's no room to put any.
So what are these?
These are my nipple paintings, and these two at the top were in a gallery in Ecuador recently, and I had a friend who was present in the gallery. I wasn't there, and she asked the people in the room what their favorite and least favorite pieces were, and everyone was saying that their favorite pieces were the beautiful, colorful landscape paintings, and then, of course, my paintings were the least favorite because they thought they were gross.
What are some of the weird comments you get from people? Do you post these online?
I have before.
Have you gotten in trouble?
No, I've never gotten in trouble, but I just don't think maybe not that many people have seen them. But my favorite comment that I get is people tell me, oh, that's my nipple. That's what my nipple looks like. And I'm like, oh, cool.
Yeah, some of those look like mine too.
Which one?
Did you get? Did someone send you reference photos? Just kidding. So why did you block your parents?
I blocked my parents on Instagram because they don't really understand why I paint the things that I paint, and they're very conservative, and they're not a huge fan of nudity, so giant nipples to them were very weird, and so I got tired of the judgment, so I blocked them.
What about this painting next to you? Would that bother them?
I think they'll be weirded out by it, especially because it's me and I'm making myself look somewhat grotesque and deformed. I don't think they'll really get it, but if I paint it well technically, then they'll be kind of proud of it.
If you painted deformed Arizona cacti, would they be weirded out by that?
No. They would probably be like, oh, that's a cool landscape.
Well, you should make one for them. So here we are at James Turrell Sky Space and Scottsdale Museum of Contemporary Art, and I'm going to test the hot spot on the Terrell at 120 degrees today?
Yep.
So that probably is about 140 degrees. Okay?
Yeah.
Hey, you okay in there? Are you sure you know how to drive in the rain?
No, dude. Not this kind of rain.
Just be careful and drive 5 miles an hour. You might be okay.
I'm going 20. Dude. Look at that. Look at the asphalt right there.
Dude. You're the most sorriest Uber driver. I'm gonna give you 1 star.
Don't do that.
I'm gonna ruin your career because you can't drive in the rain. What is this?
Oh, this is a large-scale ceramic figure that I make. Kind of like I have this exaggeration of like these creatures and monsters that kind of I come up with, and I kind of put them in this context of like socializing with the otherness.
What kind of ball sack is that?
It's got a couple eyeballs for testicles.
So he's from San Francisco?
He lives in Berkeley. I mean, for instance, this is a violet painting, but when the light changes on it, it turns completely blue. I mean, like a bright violet.
How old is he?
He's 90. He'll be 91 in January.
And how many layers of paint?
80 to 90 layers of paint, and he works with a scraper, so he doesn't use a brush.
Wow.
So if you look at the side of the paintings, that's the history. It kind of gives you an idea of what's underneath it. And he's just, you know, he's been working for many years. The early work, which was sort of work from the 60s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, these are the rainbow paintings. And as you can see, rainbow painting. And he is the only living member of the sixth gallery that was in, and it was the only great gallery in San Francisco in those early years. It's where Allen Ginsberg actually read Howl for the first time.
Let's see the cover. And you made the book?
Radius made the book. I made the book with Radius.
Oh my god, you guys, check this out. I just saw this. This is all handmade. Look at how intricate all those little lines are in all these little pieces. Like, look at those squares. This artist did not mess up once. Every single square is perfect.
Now, you're not being a smartass, right?
No, dude. I'm a ceramic artist, so I can relate with this. This is some crazy business right here. Especially this bear, dude. Look at that bear. That's fucking ferocious.
Just so funny. It looks like you're doing the Patrick Swayze. Oh god, that's so hilarious.
So what are the paintings based off, the guitars?
Yeah, all these images come from the instruments. And several of them in the show.
Wow. Where are you going to put these?
Huh?
Where are these going?
They're staying right here.
Oh, okay. But do you have an exhibition lined up?
For these?
Yeah.
Not yet.
Okay.
The show at the museum was, the installation there was the first of its kind, but I didn't only discover recently that these images grew out of my passion for the instruments.
I got it, for sure.
And it wasn't, I had work hanging on the wall And I brought a couple of instruments in because somebody was coming over to play, and I leaned them against the wall and realized that that's where all these images came from, the shapes of the guitar.
Do you play? What do you play?
I used to play, but I've got a condition called neuropathy, and my fingers don't work very good. But I'm doing some physical therapy and other kinds of stuff. The only way you really cure yourself of that is the surgery in your neck. And I was going to do that a few weeks ago when I was in L.A., and I chickened out at the last moment. You just want to show off, don't you?
What's your dog's name?
Huh? Pinky.
Pinky.
Pinky, you're good looking.
And does Pinky only stay in towels?
Huh?
Does Pinky only stay here?
She always stays with me, wherever I am. Unless I have to get on an airplane, I drive to L.A. and I take her with me. I have a studio there in Venice. I spent about 3 weeks here and about 3 weeks there. 1915.
Which one?
This one. It's called the Galliano by a guy named Oscar Schmidt. There's another one of these in the show at the museum.
Do you do ukulele?
I don't have a ukulele. Well, I do, actually.
Is that one?
No, that's something called a tipple.
Do you have an all-time favorite?
It's in the show.
Okay, and what is it?
It's made by the same guy who made that little one in the corner. That little guy and the huge one between the red and black pieces. His name was Fred Gerlach, and he lived in Venice.
Fred Gerlach.
Yeah.
Do you like Gibson guitars?
What?
Gibson.
Gibson. Those are all Gibson.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Another couple of buildings that different operations.
How long have you lived in Taos?
73.
Where were you raised?
L.A.
L.A.
I was born in Chicago, but my parents moved there to L.A. in 1945, actually, the day the Second War ended. Dad pulled a trailer with a 40 Plymouth out across Route 66. I have some vague memories of that. These are the pumps that take the air out of that one. And these are the pumps that take the air out of the big tank.
That is absolutely incredible. Wow. Did this building have to be built around this equipment?
I know. There's a big door that's sealed in that back wall underneath the window there. We dragged it in there. But we did, actually, the building was a ruin, but we had put a roof on it, and we had to get it, the equipment inside something that wasn't going to ruin it from the weather, and so in a sense we did build the building around it.
This is the driver's seat when I'm working. I watch what's happening in the tank through this window.
And while you're doing this, you're wearing like protection? What? Are you wearing like something?
No,
no?
There's no gas.
There's no anything that
escapes
that are out here. No,
I see.
No, no.
Wow.
That's a half inch thick stainless steel.
Wow.
So what's being made in there?
What?
What do you make inside here?
I make a vacuum inside. I pump the air out of it. So we need to work at very low pressures, or else when you heat up the stuff, they if there's any air in there, that it'll burn, it'll decompose.
I see.
So you have to get all the air out that would cause the material to decompose, and so.
And what year did you hire the Edwards to make this?
1968. It came in 69. Except smaller.
What are these?
Those are tests for that center panel came off of a cube that it was damaged, and so the collector asked me to try and remake that panel so that it matched the rest of them. And we are now experimenting in how I did that one. I couldn't remember. So we've got parts in the tank now of this just window glass, so that we're trying different things to get to the same coloring and the same configuration on the surface.
Can I have the reject?
Huh?
Can I have the reject?
No.
So what are you making here?
Some gnocchi.
Where'd you learn how to make that?
I went to a French restaurant and then I looked up a recipe.
What was the French restaurant?
It's called the Love Apple. It's in Taos. It's so good.
Is it Michelin rated?
Is it what?
Michelin rated?
I think they have like a pretty high rating, but I don't know if it's Michelin rating. What does that mean? Like for tires?
It means
so
the amount of people who died there from their food.
Yeah, I didn't think this was going to take so long. Poor Rizzo. Oh, Jay. But it's almost done. Super close.
So what's on it?
They're sweet potato gnocchi. Oops, sorry. Excuse me. And they're cooked in like just a sage butter.
So you have to, you boil them first?
You have to boil them and then you cook them. But they're delicious.
Gnocchi?
Gnocchi. The GN. I gotta put the gnocchi in here.
Peel, Hardy Backer, screws, glue, latex. Thin set, grout.
It was a process.
These are built to last, and they will last forever. Yeah. So it was a real treat to be a part of that project. Yeah. You can see.
It's not the public part.
It's public. It's all public. So
good old Sleeping Ewe Mountain here in the Four Corners, Colorado side. On the one end right here is the Sleeping Ewe's head, and then he's crossing his arms and down to his legs, and there's his feet right there. But from a different angle, it's more pronounced. Sleeping Ewe Mountain.
Chief mourner figure from Tahiti, and that the person who's dressed up as the character would come out and
right here,
kind of celebrate the death of someone in the village, but they're also like this symbol of mortality or ongoing mortality. So when they would come out and walk around the village, that would scare the hell out of people and remind them about all this kind of, death is always near.
Is it wearing a Tim Babington skirt?
Well, I mean, those are kind of traditional, that's the traditional dress, so they dyed all the material. But he's standing in Lake Mead, like an emptied out Lake Mead.
Uh-huh.
So, if you kind of go around the back of here, and behind this red set of rocks, the Hoover Dam's just behind here. So this is all Utah and Arizona there. So it's all kind of based on, topography, but with these symbols that I'm interested in relating to, the end of water use, really. That's the big thing.
So the Satans reside in Utah?
Well, these two roundels are the kind of supports of the states that feed water will take water from the Colorado and the snow melt and the Rocky Mountains. So, yeah, this is kind of an analogy to the Zen Eros, who used to be the water controllers. Well, I guess they still are. Like Mulholland was a water Zen Ero. And it's that, you know, it's that problem in society where we're only supposed to use as much water as we need, but we don't. Las Vegas is bad for that, so is LA.
cool thing about this is that it's elevated. Normally the hearses are just on the ground, the gallery floor. So with this you get that reflection or that mirror aspect of the top. So you can see the top of the object. And just adds that other dimension, and it relates more to that Francis Bacon painting idea that Hearst has referenced in so many of his sculptures. So these are the Hearst spot paintings, and they're all based on chemical compounds or pharmaceuticals.
So what's the story with the coasters? They're free?
Yeah, and apparently Hearst designed these, so it's part of the whole feature of the bar is that, you know, he had a hand in the creation of it.
So what's going on here?
Well, using oil paint and brush.
This is probably for the first time anyone's ever seen that. So.
Working on this little study.
And so this is just a study with...
What's this?
This is the next painting I'm gonna make.
Is it based off of my dreams?
Depends what your dreams are. Yeah.
It's a miracle. It's an EMS miracle.
Are you doing that to annoy me?
On Friday, and he's going down to Alameda's bed. So.
What are you doing?
I'm eating you because you were sleeping.
Rude. Still.
I know Kim Cantor.
So what's it like for two ladies from the South? What's it like for two ladies from the South to be in Hollywood?
Let's just say I'm getting her digits. We're in love.
You love Hollywood boys?
I don't love anything. Especially not the girly men.
Now, which one of you is a Trump supporter? The odds is that it has to be 50-50.
Yeah.
So it's her, right?
Or not her? Me.
So what do we got going on here with these guys?
I started these a long time ago, prepared them, and then everything went off the rails. So I call this steak free fall.
Free fall?
Free fall. This particular piece is called Duck on a June Bug, which is a
title I've been wanting
to use for years and years. So there's a little bit of Eve's Klein in this, a little bit of me, a little bit of John McLaughlin. There's a little bit of everything in this thing.
So the shiny surfaces are shellac?
Yeah. This one are shellac. This one and this one are raw gesso. And this is acrylic from Langridge Paints down in Australia. It's an Eve's Klein International Blue. Well, it's definitely off the rails from what I've been doing. I don't know. We'll see where it goes. Well, I love the surface on this blue one.
Yeah.
The whole, all the shellac started to, like, decompose.
So here I am with Jan Taylor again, and painting on a towel, right? You stretch it to canvas?
Yeah.
What kind of paint is this?
This is gesso. It's just black gesso. And a lot of water.
Here, you do it.
It's really pretty cool. It's just a byproduct of making the other paintings. It's just a way of cleaning this brush so that I can lay down the 40-odd coats of gesso I put on everything. So instead of throwing the towel away, now I'm going to keep it.
Where do you get the towels? Do you order them?
No, they're like from a janitor's supply. They're like for janitors that clean shit. So they're cheap. They all have this little
kind of funny
gold thing in them. So what happens then is I'm done for now because the brush is dry, and I go to one of these little panels like this.
Like how I use the word like nigga a lot in some of my works. You know, it's just like, it's, you know, it's like visual signage and then verbal signage.
And like, you know, I use them both because
I'm allowed to, because I'm black. And, you know, there's a little bit of, you know, talk about should you use the word, since, you know,
like we should maybe not say it,
but I think it's something that's part of, like, you know, my
history and like a lot of other people's history, and so to
abandon that, or to like, to not
use it as
part of like part of my reference of like, since I have to talk about being black, I'm going to do something that, you know, is entertaining to me, and like, so that's just part of the lexicon of the work of this kind of, like, it's humorous to me, and not humorous to be offensive, but it's humorous of like just the whole weight of the word and where it's gone and where it's came from, you know, how it started and what it's become, and you know, there's a lot.